system. Not seeing your family for months, and you miss them. Court days get postponed, you miss Christmas. Birthday coming up, family leaving you giftless. Ain't nobody giving you shit, you on they shit list. Niggas wanna get you hit, you on they hit list. Fuck everybody who hating, don't forget this. I wanna see your face when I make it. Take a twit pic with all this bread. Niggas could have a picnic, we hit them all instead. Fuck up a couple Benjis, I got a hood swag. 7 G's in the fitted, 40 tucked in the Fendi. Got a nigga limping, on my A-game. Never slip on my pimping, never lack in the field. Chicken niggas get grilled, better watch your surroundings. And the team that you build, better use your antennas. You can sense if he real. If you a real nigga, you know what it is. I'm trying to do business, rhyme at night, let's make a deal. Had these niggas bluffing, acting like they real. How you got baby, but you ain't got no crib. Claiming he the plug, and he sitting on the mill. I'm from Baltimore City, that much money get you killed. Niggas get that much money, don't know how to live. They fuck it all up, on clothes, cars, and pills. They make it sound good, I'ma give you the real. I know a nigga looking at me like, is he real? Listen to the shit that I speak, and you can tell. I made a bounce back before, right off the ground. I ain't talking basketball, that ain't my style. So many goddamn pills, we ran out. Call a pack minor and tell them bring more out. Dope fiends rushing, they trying to get more now. Every day I'm clutching this pistol part on my style. All I know is hustling, been doing this for a while. Now they got me rapping and people feeling my style. Performing on stage, feeling energy from the crowd. Got them going wild, scooter up next, they shout. Been thugging since a child, acting up, running wild. Got committed to the state when I was only like 12. I ain't never had no father, my mother raised me herself. She say I'm hard-headed, told me I don't listen. I told her I'ma make it, cause mine, I got a vision. That's why I don't take no shit from no pussy-ass nigga. Threaten me, you could get it, cause my mother need me living. Real life, I'm speaking facts. I see an opportunity, I'ma take the chance. I know they gon' hate, let me say fuck them in advance. I ain't worrying about them snakes, I already cut the grass. Up next, I'm campaigning. I grind hard, this shit draining. Hard work pay off, so I can take it. These niggas faking till they make it. But all that hating don't need faming. Some type of way that hating made me. I'm built to last, these niggas can't break me. That's why they mad, cause they can't take me. What up?
That's Lil Scooter, the hottest nigga in Baltimore right now. The young generation. Matter of fact, he the hottest on the East Coast. See, I like him. For yo to be so young, he rap about shit I went through in my life. You know what I mean? Get it out the mud. That's all we knew where I came from, is the mud. A lot of niggas be talking about they from the hood. That's exactly where you from, the hood. We from the projects. That's the hood inside the hood. We like the motherfuckers that like people forgot about, you know what I mean? So we had to make it our own way. We the reason why they invented social service, for real. Project people. That's a lot of people don't understand. Like the
keep it 100.
Keep it 100.
Keep it 100.
Keep it 100.
Yeah,
Bodie
wasn't no motherfucker. I know
where
you get from. Wild state.
Turn around, tell the camera
that. Wild was state. It wasn't what? Nothing like real life for real. That ain't how we carried it for real. We didn't even know that nigga property was in the show. We don't even know where it came from. He's bum on that. Don't know nothing about them niggas.
Yeah, you can respect it because they made money. But the real niggas, everybody know who the real Springer them is. Everybody know who the real Bodie them is. The dudes ain't get paid for that shit.
Yeah, man, the Wadi, man, is based on our projects, man. Murphy Gone from Lexington Paris, man. Hey, but they, where we from. We lived that shit.
Hey, that was every day. It was easy for you to be walking with a nigga, walk through a hole. which we used to call the pit.
Everybody couldn't walk through the hole.
Mind your business. Walk with a nigga. The nigga might fall. Your best thing to do, keep walking.
When y'all watch the fall, y'all don't know. When y'all watch the wire and y'all hear him say the pit, man, we three of you can invent that word pit. We invented that word.
Shit.
The pit is really called the hole.
I'm Bobby Harper. I want him to tell us a little bit about me. Man, let me tell you something about this man. This man got me my first ass whipping when I was a kid, man. I was coming from Rip Young's wreck, and him, he was walking up, and the police was fucking with him and shit. And I'm a little ass kid. I'm about 8 years old, and he called me over there. He said, "You want to make $5? I'm like, "Yeah, I want to make $5. He said, "Man, I normally wouldn't do this to you, but I'm going to do it right now because I need you. But just know, you're not going to be in harm's way, and I got my eyes on you." So I said, "All right, what's up?" He gave me a book bag full of money, man. That was the most money I ever seen in my life at that age, man. Acting like $30,000, and my mother caught me, and I got my ass whipped, and he ain't defend me. That's what the fuck happened.
Man, it's a nice day out this motherfucker. I mean, as usual, it's crowded around here. You know what I mean? They just doing what they do best. Trying to survive, man. Trying to feed their family. You know? It's what they do on a daily basis. On a daily basis around here. This is called Legends right here. Number one black person food store is called Legends. This is the hangout right here for us. You know what I mean? Now, I mean, it ain't the projects no more. Not the projects. The projects is here now. You ain't gonna get the projects, you gonna get people who came out the projects.
A lot of motherfuckers think a motherfucker gets wake up in the morning and say, "I'm gonna go outside and sell drugs," or "I'm gonna go outside and rob somebody." A motherfucker don't do that. You grasp you that shit. You don't got nothing. You know what I mean? Like, for instance, I'm 36 years old. I've been on my own since I was basically 13. Ain't nobody do nothing for me or give me nothing since I was 13. You know how many years that is? But I mean by give me nothing, I'm talking about like, for like a birthday present, a Christmas gift. I ain't had that since I was 13. You know what I mean? And some of my homeboys, when I was 13, they was 9 and 8. So they ain't had that shit since then. So all a nigga knew was the hustle, like, oh, you know what I mean? Like, it's hard. I mean, if you ain't never been through it, you wouldn't understand what I'm trying to say to you.
At an early age, Anton started selling drugs to survive, to eat, to feed himself. I mean, you know, to clothe himself, his sisters and brothers. So a lot of things Anton's exposed to, I take responsibility for him, because Anton went from being a loving, caring son in school to missing school and doing some things outside his room that he never would have did to survive. And he was exposed to the streets, whereas though he started stealing, selling drugs, lying, cheating, and manipulating just to get, not to feed him, but just his sisters and brothers and me. And that's what I liked it about Anton the most. He ain't gonna just do for himself. He gonna make sure the next person got it too. So that's one of the examples I can use, whereas though, cause there's plenty of more that Anton had to become from a boy to a man.
Straight stand up guy, ain't gonna never stand wrong. You know what I mean? If he ain't got nothing, whatever you ask him, he gonna straight give you the truth. If he ain't got it, he ain't got it. If he got it, he got it. But the thing, mainly, if he ain't got it, he still gonna give it to you. Make sure you got it. That's the That's one thing about it, man, that I love, man. Genuine, sincere, gangster. We've been raised around a whole bunch of other gangsters. It's gonna give you facts, man.
I know, I see, man. I still got
my Uncle Lee.
Pulled went pro. You know what I mean? Football or basketball, pick your course. It's one of my original boys, like, you up in 5 years, bro. And it's a real struggle. It's the babysitting, that's crazy. He's only 3 years older than him, you know what I mean? He got in an incident, you know what I mean? Mistaken our family, he lost his leg and shit. So, you know, now he's here, you know what I mean? Trying to do what you gotta do to take care of his kids, you know what I mean? Like I said, most of us wasn't, you know, we was forced in. You understand what I'm saying? This somebody only 3 years older than me. That's still looking up to him, man. You know what I mean? I see him lost his leg, he's still doing his dad taking his family, man. You know what I mean? I told y'all to be all day, man. That's one of my real homies, man. My man Dukes, man. You know what I mean? I call him Milkweed, though. He a petty motherfucker, though. I love him like a brother. You know what I mean? Leave it alone. You know what I mean? It's not that, like, your family ain't care about you or shit like that, but shit was just tough. Then we were some hard-headed little motherfuckers. But we was always like survivors and we always stuck together. So if it gets like, it gets came to you, you think everybody in there like that, you know what I mean? So it wasn't nothing to go outside, get a pack from somebody and get started hustling because you only did it to take care of yourself. You didn't do it because you wanted to, you know what I mean? Like, especially when school came back, you know what I mean? Your motherfucker had to go to school. You weren't going to school, you ain't had no new clothes, no new school uniform. Our mothers ain't buying that shit. Our mothers was getting high. Or probably in jail or getting drunk. So we ain't go back to school until like the second week of school because we had to wait on checks to come out. You know what I mean? A lot of motherfuckers ain't never go through that, waiting on no checks just to go to school. You know what I mean? End up we ain't one go. So that's like a lot, that's how a lot of motherfuckers got caught up back in my days, like not wanting to go to school. Niggas ain't want to go to school and be embarrassed, looking all crazy and shit, head all night because you ain't got the money to get your hair cut. You know what I mean? Niggas went through all that type of shit.
Yeah, man, real niggas, man. Respected shit, man. Everywhere, man. Yeah, man, my man, Uncle Luke. Slickest uncle I got, man. I get that shit from him, you see me. Get that shit from him, man. This shit ain't about nothing, man. He in the hood. I learned a lot from this man. One of the old slickest old uncles I got, man. Been doing this shit from hood to hood. We well respected and well connected.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
We ain't from the same hood, but our love like is we from the same hood. You know what I mean? That's what he do. He a real, real street nigga. Well respected. OG in this shit, man.
OG out here, man.
You know what I mean?
Niggas,
that's the OG of this shit right here. You see this nigga? You see it? I'm a slick little nigga. Ask me who I get it from.
You better believe it.
Tell him what I am, Uncle Lee.
Okay, it's one of the stickiest niggas in West Baltimore right there. You remind me of me when I was young.
Yeah, real
man.
Shit.
You know what I mean?
Chase papers. Oh, Uncle Luke, Chase, that's all we do, Chase papers, man. Uncle Luke will tell you, man. I'm telling y'all following, y'all doing a nice project on a real nigga. The right nigga, too, because he ain't going to style y'all wrong.
Tell him what city you in.
Man, we in Baltimore, West Baltimore at that,
know,
man.
Y'all already know.
Baltimore, y'all West Baltimore, know, man. Real niggas, man. Niggas just starting to get up the par. Niggas catching up, man. These niggas playing catch up. We've been doing this shit. Making money. Fucking bitches. Looking good.
Damn,
man.
We done it all. Man.
Cars.
Did it all, man.
Dice games.
Ain't about nothing, man.
Robberies, all that shit, man. You know what I mean? Shit.
Get them going in the store.
You make sure you got to see us. Yeah, man.
Say hi to your face, girl.
That's my girlfriend and Jordan over there. My sister and
say
my
hi,
girl.
Sir.
That type of shit. Yeah, man. Hey, yo. Say hi to the camera, yo.
Right there. Freddy.
Right here.
Get a move on there.
Trap of the
year
right
there, man. You ain't got trap of the year. Oh, trap of the year right there, man.
Story with
Luton.
First shot of ass to the
last shot of ass.
You know what I mean? Still here. That's a good thing about, like, niggas when you grow up, you know what I mean?
it's about still being here. Feel me?
Yo!
Y'all ain't no niggas are fast, motherfucker, too, bro.
One of the fastest.
He always took on the responsibilities of being a man when he was young. You know, taking his sisters to school, providing for them, you know. And then he followed the tradition of the uncles. Because, you know, we was always hard workers. You know what I mean? Some of us, you know, we had to find our way later on in life, but we family. You see what I'm saying? And I give honor to Lucas because, you know, he always was there for us when we wasn't there for ourselves.
The worst thing I ever seen my mother go through while she was using drugs, her being ill. I remember one day she was ill. I was on Ogden Huffman, yeah, when the pride gets us up. And I had to cook. I knew she wanted to cook. I let my mother stay ill, yo, for like a good hour. But when I seen her start begging other motherfuckers for shit, that shit crushed me. I couldn't believe it, you know what I mean? Like, we come from an era where when we was outside on the corner hustling, our mother was out on the corner with us. You understand what I'm saying? That's some shit, ain't it? Like, think about it. You on the hole giving out testers at the age of 14 years old and your mother in the line. What you supposed to do when it get to her? You know what I mean? That's when that shit, it's like when in the movie, when it be a little ass boy and it be the world and the whole world be spinning at one time, you guys gotta make this sudden move. Man, you know how many of us went through that shit in our life, yo? Well, you know what I mean? You know how many manly decisions that we had to make as a child? I'm talking about manly decisions. I'm talking about real manly decisions, man. Coming down the exit, a nigga got a gun in the nigga mouth. Do I keep running? Do I look? You know what I mean? All that type of shit. You know what I mean? Manly decisions, man. So it's gonna always go back to my mother, because she taught me everything. She taught me about females, good niggas, bad niggas. She taught me about a lot, man. So my mother was the biggest influence in my life anywhere around the board, whether it was anyway. Seeing her get high made me strong as a motherfucker, boy. That shit made me stay away from that shit, you know what I mean? I seen my mother go through that shit. That shit like some heartbreaking ass shit, you know what I mean? It was to one point that my mother was going to die, you know what I mean? When he passed away from using that shit. And it's crazy that a nigga can say that and still wake up and go sell that shit tomorrow morning. But when you know you young, you don't look at all that shit like that. You don't think that shit real. You don't think that shit real. You don't think your mother can OD up, no coke up, no dope, no shit like that. You don't even think your man can get sprung out that shit. Some niggas got niggas' mans who sprung out that shit right now. You know what I mean? You don't think you're gonna go through that shit when you growing up. You know what I mean?
He would not give me money, man. I think my son wanted me to get clean more than I wanted me to get clean. Because I would come around there and he'd be like, "Mom, get yourself a job. What you doing around here? Didn't I tell you about coming around here?" And he would just give me $1.63. And I ain't know what it was for, but I took it. Yeah, so Anton a character. He don't forget nothing, no dates, no times, no year. You know. Wow, making me think about fighting and stuff. I used to fight all the time, but that I had to. You had to survive down the projects, cause if they didn't, they was gonna take advantage of you. The only fight I remember Anton being in was the fighting with the boy, and I had to make him fight, cause the boy kept. The new, you know, they was new in the neighborhood. Their whole family was a bully. And actually, the lady I beat up for Anton was aunt. And they would always pick on Anton and my son, Bigum. And I had to make Anton beat him up. And from that point on, I never knew Anton fought nobody else. He was just a good guy. At the right time. Now, I ain't saying he perfect, because he got some shit with him. Let me say
yes,
that.
He did.
We got to remind him of some stuff.
You know, Baby Holmes definitely on the map in them joints, man. Because we raised gorillas. Yeah. We raised gorillas, man. Real gorillas. I ain't talking about monkeys. We raised gorillas.
Yeah. Back in them days, it was a project thing. It was a thing to see who project was the toughest, you know what I mean? You heard about LT niggas, and you heard about Murphy Old niggas. I guess, you know what I mean? Shit, I was hanging in Murphy Holmes, and I'm going on down the projects down Lexington Terrace. Shit, Shout out to them niggas. LT niggas. Shout out Murphy Home niggas. Even shout out to my Lafayette Project niggas. You know what I mean? Lil Tank and them. You know what I mean? Yeah. Came up, nigga. You know what I mean? Real nigga shit.
Everybody come walk through the projects. That was the Baltimore. That was the whole Baltimore. You know what I'm saying? Before they took all the projects in Baltimore. You go up New York, they still had projects up there. You go to Brooklyn, they still, in Queens, they still had project buildings.
Right.
Baltimore don't have it no more. That's what took a lot away from Baltimore, because a lot of people who live in the projects now live in different areas, which is cool. It's great. But at the same token, the projects was like survival of the fittest. If you didn't know somebody, if you wasn't, had some type of heart, you couldn't walk through. And it's like, a lot of people don't believe it. Even people from this area, if you didn't live that life, you can't relate to it. But it was serious. It was a point where you couldn't even walk through a certain block. The projects, if you wasn't on that, or at least had the heart to be on that, you couldn't walk through the project. You had to walk around 2-3 blocks and go past the project, because you had a whole bunch of young black men, how it is nowadays, they had this on their chest. You know what I'm saying? They dig in your pockets. You know what I'm saying? I don't think no man like nobody digging in their pockets. But if you ain't had no heart to fight back, whatever you had, $2, $5, so it's coming out your pocket.
But to be honest, I don't know. You know, now, it's like whoever can walk on 2 feet, they throw it in their head. That wasn't how it was when we came. There's no way. You know, Murphy Holmes stuck together. You know, it's a unity thing. Nothing when it came to the truck. We always had problems with these guys, those guys, these guys. But we were taught, in a sense, from, like I say, the older guys, how to deal with a lot of things that goes on out here in the streets. And these kids nowadays, they didn't have anybody to do that. That's why I say a lot of people keep saying the kids' fault, the kids that it's not their fault. You know, it's guys that came before them that didn't teach them the things that they need to know to deal with the street life.
Survival is the only mode that your mind is thinking of. So you got to survive out there, and a lot of people wanna shy away from what's real out here. Them projects is real. You know, the struggle is real. So, you know, all this talking about, well, they could have did this, they could have did that. No, they couldn't have did this, and they couldn't have did that if certain programs was taken from you, the recreation centers was taken from you, what nothing for you to do.
So, right, my mother lived right next door to the store, right off Arnold and Huffman. And I had to get her from down there, that shit was just getting that bad. That's by 1058. As soon as I moved out, these little motherfuckers go in there and knocked a hole in the wall, robbed the whole store, took everything out of there, made the old lady. They was in a store called Sears or some shit. So, like, a little side store, like, you know, me moving down there, I don't know if that was a good thing or bad thing, but Murphy Homes, I'm gonna say between that and the Lafayette Projects. Lafayette Projects, that shit was cool, but I think Murphy Homes was just a whole nother different world. You either got in when you fit in, or you fell by the wayside.
All the labels and all the things that they labeled Murphy Homes as being, you know, you actually had to live in the projects to know that it was some good things about the projects. Think about all the people that made it coming out of the projects. You see what I'm saying? And look, 86 years later, my mother's still around. You know what I mean? And she was the cornerstone of the projects. You see what I'm saying? Like I said, learning, paying attention, getting out my own way, you know, doing the right things. Now I'm looking at me today, and I know all that was because of the projects.
Yes,
that's a real nigga.
Yeah, look at these niggas for real though. Yeah, look out for niggas, give niggas a couple dollars and shit. You know, make the sell words on the boulevard. Yeah, give niggas a little hustle and shit. Yeah,
you know, nigga, ice cream will be hot in the lot tonight.
I got my nephew right there. Nephew! Nephew! Put the dice down and come holler at your uncle, baby. Tell him to hold the dice real quick, man. Oh, my nephew's right here.
Got the camera. Oh, I'm shorty. Bro, got big uncle round here.
Tyson.
Big Unk around here. Hey, Big Unk, man.
Yeah, that's my man, Big Unk, man. Make sure we good, man. Yeah. Yeah. Come through, holla at niggas, man.
Motherfucker, Godfather of the hood.
Sponsor of the hood. You mean he's sponsoring niggas.
You on this shit right now, man. Big Luke right here, man.
It's Big Luke,
shit,
man.
I'm at Ray Clark with this DVD for all you fuck niggas. And my man fucked a lot of you niggas bitches.
A lot.
A whole gang of you niggas.
A whole soiree of you niggas.
We ain't gonna say no names. We ain't gonna say no names. But y'all know who we talking about, though. My own fuck them bitches.
Females, man. I done ran with the best of them females. You know what I mean? Everybody know that. Not the Greg. But you know what I mean? When you coming up in a society where the dude is in front of you that you looking up to, and they dealing with all these females, you think, I mean, that's what you want. You know, that's what I wanted. I knew I was gonna like females. You know, we had dudes like my man Archie, you know what I mean, my man Yop, my man Bud, Pop. These dudes had women chasing them, like running behind them. I remember times they just had 2 and 3 women at one time sitting on Ogle Avenue waiting for him. So me saying that, it trickled down to me. And then it got to the point where though they would use me and my homeboys, whereas though they would get the woman they was dealing with, like they had sex with us. Like I don't know if they would give them money or like it was like a competition thing. If I actually get something done for his little man, he gotta get something done for his little man, which is me. So I'm exposed to these women. And that shit became an addiction and I didn't know. So when I got older, I always had a thing for women, so it was hard for me to like to be faithful with anybody. You understand what I'm saying? I was like here with one woman, there with one woman. I was just, it was just crazy, you know what I mean? But you don't realize how much you're hurting these girls because you're dealing with all these different girls at one time. You lying to them, you telling this girl this, you telling this girl that. It become an addiction and you don't even know it. And before you know, you find yourself and probably slept with half of the city. You know what I mean? Not to brag or it ain't, I mean, it's a good thing that diseases wasn't in the high rate back then. You understand? It was times where though I would actually leave out my girlfriend's house and probably have another girl around the corner waiting for me. 5 or 6 times a month that would go on. You know what I mean? You got 2 or 3 girls waiting for you, lying about this. I mean, then you just get tired of that shit. So females, like, that was a big part of my life for a long time, but until I realized that I was hurting a lot of girls. You know what I mean? I don't know who had feelings for me, who didn't. You know what I mean? You don't care about that type of shit. But you know what I mean? I got tired of doing it for a lot of reasons because how it is, like, niggas killing over females. You know what I mean? You gotta think about you dealing with a female, he killed you, so you dead, he in jail, and she would have never known. So that's another reason why I stopped running around with all these girls like that. Because a lot of dudes weak and soft for females like that. And then, I mean, there's a lot of reasons why I stopped doing that. I got older, man. That's one of the reasons I got smart. Anybody got time running behind these girls, they think they're going to get something from you, or this, that, and third. You know what I mean? You had them once, you had them off. You know what I mean? There's nothing. It's just life. Females part of life, man. You know what I mean? Right now, I ain't with all that no more, man. I'm almost 40 years old. I'm one and done. Now we get a chapter. You know what I mean? I felt like I need to talk about because, I mean, that was a big part of my life, man. I still had fun running out there. You know what I mean? That was a competition thing. How many girls you had sex with? How many girls you slept with? How many girls you can get? How many girls that be together? You know what I mean? You dealing with girls who hang together. You might have sex with 5 out of 10 girls who hang together. That was like a macho thing back then. You know what I mean? You got this girl parked on Pennsylvania and Preston, this girl parked on Dolphin Street, this girl parked right there. That was a macho thing. And all your mans, you know, they cheering you on. Oh, yo this, yo this. So they become a norm. Not just me. I mean, it was a lot of us like that. But I'm just saying, I was just one of the ones who really kept, honestly, I said, man, I was addicted to women for a long time. You know what I mean? That's what I liked it. You know what I mean? Like the party. But you don't realize who you're hurting as you're doing those things, you know? You understand what I'm saying? Yes, out there living that life, you ain't worried about no disease. That's why I say it's thankfully that, you know what I mean, I got through all that shit without catching nothing, you know what I mean, it can kill me. You know, that's serious. You know what I mean, a lot of these females, man.
All right. Talk about a time where niggas did something special for you.
Niggas did something special for me? You know we got the same birthday. So every birthday, you did something special for me.
Okay.
That's Everybody stop the thing. Twins,
so, like, growing up with Lucas and seeing being in the streets, you ever see him have any, like, hard times?
No.
You
know how I get money. That's one thing I can say about him.
What can you say about the people that he have around him, though?
He ain't gonna have nobody around him that he can't trust.
You know what I mean? But if I had to take you back, I remember when Murphy homes were just dirt. You know, coming from Preston Street, you know, I watched the projects come up. You see what I'm saying? And then coming up in the projects, that's where I found myself best at. You know, through some of the people that I knew, you know, the hustlers, you know what I mean? You know, playing sports, you know. I mean, you know, then when we was coming up at that time, you know, we had some forerunners such as my mother, you know, Miss Dorothy, Miss Elaine, you know what I mean? We had people that were for us that paved the way for us. So it was easy for us to fall in the footsteps of them because, you know, they paved the way for us. You see what I'm saying? But I know if you lived in the projects, you can go anywhere and hustle. Because to me, the projects wasn't nothing but a trade school. You can go anywhere in the world and hustle. You see what I'm saying?
Growing up where I grew up, it was like living in Baghdad. You know what I mean? Iraq or some shit. You know what I mean? Like really seeing dead bodies every day, all day. I know I've probably seen like 15 to 20 dead bodies in my life. And I seen most of them before the age of 20. You know what I mean? Like bodies laying in the exit. Somebody got shot right there. Somebody laying over there. That was the normal life of shit. Motherfuckers just laying around dead, getting shot every day.
Introduce yourself, man.
What's up, world? Yeah. It's the Colonel.
I ain't gonna cut you off. Man, come on, man. Come up that thing, man. Let these people hear who this is, man.
What's up, world? It's the Colonel speaking, man. Uncle Luke, man, a.k.a. Anton Carter. Lucas, whatever you want to call it, man. Mr. Murphy Holmes, talk to me.
Right. And when you jumped out there into the streets, did it just take off for you? Like, was you one of the biggest out there doing it? Like, what was it like?
See, this is how it was. When I first started hustling, of course, you underneath somebody. You always underneath somebody. You work your way in.
Right.
I was the skeleton.
Right.
I ain't out there asking much for no package.
Right.
You know what I mean? And Ninja seen me and seen the potential of me as a leader and pulled me up and said, "Bob, boy, you want this package?" And I said, "Yeah, of course, why not? I thought you would never ask." That's how I felt. What took you so long?
Right.
So I got the package. It was me and my man Tyree. You know what I mean? Shouts out to my man Buttercup. That's the first person I ever was like my partner.
Right.
You know, we was about 14 years old. We was hooking school, actually.
Right.
And two of my homeboys, they was a little older to us, you know what I mean? They're name irrelevant right now. They, you know what I mean? They came to us and asked us what was up. We got down with them. They gave us the work. And we were doing $20,000 a day. This is at the age of 14 years old. I'm saying $20,000 touch my hands. At least 10 of it. The other 10 touching my man hand. This is a child.
Right.
I don't know what the F going on out here.
Right.
All ones are bad nights. You know, I ain't tripping about nothing else. So as you go to that, of course, you go in and out, transition to getting locked up, getting incarcerated, going to Boys Village, going to Hickey School, you're going away from your family at a young age. You're going for 9 months, 18 months, and you're learning other things from other ninjas like me, from the projects, real dudes. Because all we breed is real dudes. I don't care what project you're from, you got to be real. I don't care if you was born on the moon. If it was a project on the moon, you're the realest in the city.
Yeah.
I don't care where you're from, east or west. I salute all project dudes because we went through the struggle, man. You know what I mean? But anyway, back to the story. It went from that to a crew. You know, we had a crew. It was me, my little cousin Mikey, T, Ham, that's Mikey, Todd, let his soul rest, Terry, let his soul rest. We had little Miles, he was a baby. And I say little baby, Miles is 9 years old out there.
Right.
He was nine years old, my man Miles. Then we had his brother, Doughboy, a few other us up there. We started off as a crew of 10, and my man Lil Marnie, Big A Marnie. But any old way, but a few of us, ain't you think I can go all day long?
Yeah.
But we always had a pact where as though whatever we do, we gonna do together.
Right.
So three of us might work for this dude, three of us might work for this dude, and three of us work for this dude. But we all working together. You know what I mean? Because we got money in our shoe,
money over here, money over there. So we kids saving all this money, but we ain't realizing the importance of the money. We don't know nothing about saving the money. We ain't worried about getting our own product, because we know these, as long as these dudes out there, we gonna be good. So you stuck in that mindset. But we was different, though. We weren't with the other. Once we got like 16, 17 years old, we was already smart enough to realize, all right, this is how you do. We gonna get this on the side. I might go get an 8-ball, a quarter. That was a lot back then.
Right.
You know what I mean? When I was selling drugs, I was selling heroin. These kids ain't selling no heroin. They don't even know what they selling. Right. I was selling shit that can take a 30.
Right.
When my man give me a pack, he know by the time he snap his finger, I'm bringing the money back. That's how easy it was.
Right.
You know what I mean? It was easy, but it was hard. Because we made 200,000 to 300,000. Man, listen, man. When I say money, man, look at me in my face sometimes. I'm talking about money, man. And from 1989 to 1995, Murphy Owen Projects alone on the corners of Argo and Huffman, Myrtle and Huffman, Shields and Huffman, probably accumulated $150,000 every day.
Wow.
I don't care if it was Sunday.
Wow.
It's every single day. So you're a kid. Just imagine a person out there, they call them corner men now. We call them towers. We had towers out there where they don't even get a dollar of each pill. You understand what I'm saying?
Project show enough. But this motherfucking nigga over here holding him up and shit, right? Here he come now. Cause I came up under him. When 851 was jumping off when they had the 60s and the 30s and the 40s down there. You know what I mean? That's where everything really started up at 851, you know what I mean? That's when shit was real live, you know what I mean? That's what dope was dope back then. You know what I mean? Couldn't know anybody come down there and no projects to sell no motherfucking dope or none of that. You know what I mean? Even that's some Tarantino, you know? Hey, Cap!
Shit, you can go back from Bo White. You can go back from facing all the old dudes. Andre Poole. Everybody. You ain't that shit that wasn't even allowed in that way. The other side of the terrace, they was cool with us. Even though, you know, we had our own little shit going on. But man, nah.
Nothing like Murphy Holmes.
Nah, Murphy was Murphy. We walk around with it every day. It's tatted on us. We the first league with tats. This shit for real. See, that motherfucker is just from 72. Yeah, it wasn't just MHP. A homeboy of mine tied it up. Ain't no, we ain't go to no stores, we ain't go to nothing. All us stayed by Suze. Everybody know who Suze was.
Suze, all
going to Huffman. All going to Huffman. Phone booth. You should, I'm quite sure Twan got some footage of what it was.
Yeah,
he
got it.
Everybody couldn't just walk in Suze and order no food.
Right.
You had to be accepted to even come in that motherfucker. When it was,
Scotty's
first. It was called, really was called Blues.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then you got a lot of dudes that, you know, act like they really from Murphy. They ain't from Murphy for real.
Ain't from Murphy Holmes, man. You got a lot of fakers, man, you know. But we set the groundwork down there, man, and we paid our dues, man, and we did what we had to do to survive. Now, I tried to save a few dollars. You know what I'm saying to you? I got me a house, couple other things, my truck here, my other van right there, because we knew it wasn't going to last, you know, but we had to do what we had to do to survive, you know. So right now, I'm just taking it one day at a time, Jack, trying to just give back. You know, I get my grandkids on the weekends. That's where I get my joy in now. I don't hang out in the streets no more. I don't do none of that. I just get my grandkids. As a fact, they should be here in the next 10 to 15 minutes, man. I got a beautiful wife, man. I got married, Jack. So right now, I'm on some laid-back shit, man. I ain't doing nothing that's
out of character. Yeah, yeah. Murphy Holmes is special because of the loyalty and the love. Everybody protecting each other. Everybody watching each other's kids. So it wasn't about the drugs and the violence. It was about the loyalty. That's what everybody didn't have about the neighborhood. They ain't had the loyalty. Everybody stuck together, like I said earlier in the interview. If you fought one, then you fought 2,000, 3,000. That was the scary part. That's why we dominated Baltimore at one time the way we did, because everybody stuck together. So Murphy Holmes has basically built the loyalty. X out all the drugs, all the violence, everything we've been through, all the struggle. Loyalty the number one thing. That's why we had the most muscle. That's that.
So we've been hearing a lot of Mike Ham through the whole documentary with Luke. This is kind of the first real sit down we really get. Can you,
Yeah,
this is the real first real sit down. So can we,
Come on, man. You know I always get the bad reputation, man.
Nah, from what Luke been saying, you a good guy, you feel me? No matter what nobody else saying.
I try to be, man.
Gotcha.
So you know, some house away, I always get the bad reputation, man.
Why you think that is, though?
I don't know, man. It's a lot, man. I had a cousin, right, that looked just like me too. His name was Biggs, best friend too, cousin. So when he used to get in trouble, Van Bobby looked like it was always the light-skinned guy with the freckles. So basically, I used to get a lot of his charges. He can did something early that day. I can been in the house. Like, I'm gonna give you a example. One day, I was in the house all day. I come outside. This is when we had housing authority police. So there's a lady in the back of housing authority in the back of the car, the police car. So I'm riding my bike. I'm riding down. She, I'm about like 12, 13 years old. So she pointing at me. So people around the projects, around our community, they telling me to go, go, go. I'm like, go for what? The lady saying I armed robbed her. So Van Bob, that's the situation. I wasn't trying to deal with it at the time. I takes off. They chase me all through the projects, running my own house, make a long story short. Little petty little situation that my cousin got into an altercation with a lady early, got the fuss or whatever, but I got the charge. Van Bob, we looked alike. And that used to always be the situation though.
Right, right.
Not to say I ain't never used to get into shit.
I love all my cousins for different reasons, that's my best cousin, Mikey. I said he my best cousin. You know what I mean? We need each other, me and him, because we live in the same world, you know what I mean? We just bump heads a lot because we just live in the same world, We struggle to go. But you know that make you love and make a nigga love each other more though. You know what I mean? I got a big family. My sisters, I don't really spend a lot of time with my sisters, right? Like I should, because they live so far away. But these my girls. See my cousin Lisa. That's why I love her so much, man, because if it wasn't for her, I don't know where my sisters would be, because my mother was getting high real bad. She came and took them from my mother. Like, literally took them. Like, I'm taking them. Her and my mother, her and my aunt Naka, which is her mother. You know what I mean? And they took them. They grew up in the county and shit, so they ain't really had to go through that shit I went through as much. They left when they was like 6 years old. You know what I mean? Because I don't know if they would have been able to handle what we went through, what we seen. You know what I mean? Especially what my mother went through, man. But little girls can't handle that much stuff like little boys. You know what I mean? Saying their mother getting high like that, it would have fucked their heads up. So I love you for that, Lisa, and not for doing that. That was like the biggest thing y'all ever did for me in my life, was taking my sisters away from the projects and giving them a better chance. And they turned out perfect. You know what I mean? But for a long time, I blamed my father for my mother getting high. You know what I mean? I don't know if I never told him that, but what I did, because my father like a strong nigga, man. Like he's so strong, like he supportive. Even to this day, I can call my father right now. You know what I mean? He'll beat me out of the situation that I'm in. You know what I mean? And I'm a grown ass man. But me saying that shit as a child, like, it's like my father went to jail, everything went downhill. He went to jail like in 89, 90, caught like 15, 20 years. No, he caught 25 years. And it was like my mother, like, I know if he was on the streets, even though they wasn't together, he'd have been in her ass. Whereas though she wouldn't have got her. I know she wouldn't have. So for a long time, I blamed him for my mother getting her, because he went to jail. And I felt like he left my mother out there, because they depended on each other, even though they wasn't together, you know what I mean? But it wasn't his fault, though. But he back, you know what I mean? He been back in my life for like the last 11 years. We got a good relationship like it always started, you know what I mean? That's my nigga, David, you know? I wouldn't trade him in for anybody. That's the best father in the world. That nigga took care of me while he was in jail for 15 years. I don't know how the fuck he did it, but he did it. So, y'all should cherish y'all mothers and y'all fathers no matter what they go through, getting high. I know that shit be embarrassing sometimes, and you don't want to claim them, but man, that's your parents. Some motherfuckers ain't got no parents, man. My mother been near death like 3 times, like since I can remember. That shit's scary as shit, you know what I mean?
That shit will bring the gangster about a nigga. Seeing your mother go through some shit that you know you can't do nothing about it. You know what I mean? So the only thing I did for my mother to get us from was talk to her, encourage her, tell her I love her and how much I need her in the world, you know what I mean? And now she's doing her thing, you know what I mean? So sometimes you need to encourage motherfuckers, man, that's doing bad things or doing things to their body. You gotta let them know how bad it's hurting you. My mother hurt me for years, man, but I ain't never tell her. But all the hurting she did to me made me strong. It made me like solid as a rock, you know what I mean? But I did that. My mother, I went through a lot, you know what I mean? I raised my sisters and my brothers. You know what I mean? Myself. But I'm proud of my mother, man. You know what I mean? I wouldn't treat her ass for nothing either. She's getting my damn nerves, though.
Bigum. His name was David, but we called him Bigum because at a young age, he just ate everything. He was big. I mean, he broke the stroller, high chair, walking, anything. And when he grew up, he had a passionate heart. But for me being his mother, I think society was a part of him getting killed because of the way his lifestyle was. At the age of 7, I had to put him away. And from 7 all the way up until he was 20, when he passed away, he was in and out of jail. And I can remember times where, you know, if he got to know you, he was your friend to the end. And I can remember one time he wanted me to come home because I was out there using. And he took the palm of his hand and just palmed my head and curved me all the way home. I miss my son, and for a long time I couldn't even say his name without crying, or I'll call Anton or my other son, Mook, which is Quivante, Bigum, you know what I'm saying? It's been 14 years, and he's well missed, and people still talk stories about him because he was a good kid, you know. I don't want to talk about him no more, because I'm going to start crying, I'm telling you, I'm starting telling you, Bigum, you know, and it's crazy because I remember when I was telling you, you know, the night before he got killed, he called me about 11:30 at night where he was locked up at, and he told me he was on his way home. I mean, I said, boy, what you doing on the phone? He was like, Mom, I'm home. And I dropped the phone and ran to my supervisor and was like, it ain't time. So the next day I seen him. He was down there seeing his nephew for the first time. And he was riding his 10-speed bike, and this friend of his named Moo was had this moped, and he was on the back of the moped holding on to the moped with the bike, and I watched him go all the way up Pennsylvania Avenue, man, until he disappeared. And the next time I seen my son, it was actually in the casket, because I didn't go see him after he got shot. I was scared. And it's crazy because when he got killed, you know, my youngest son was there, Moot, and Anton wasn't. So we looking for Anton, and everybody looking for Anton. Anton driving around with a couple of his friends, he wasn't aware that his brother got killed. And a couple of his friends was driving behind Anton. So Anton was running from the car because he didn't know what was up. You know, he was in that lifestyle, he didn't know what was going on. And to a point where Anton just said, he just stopped the car and said, whatever was going to happen, going to happen. He said he parked the car, or he just jumped out the car, I don't know if he parked, and just ran to the car as to say, what's up, what you watching me for? And it was a bunch of his friends telling him that his brother passed. You know, and he was telling me that story. And it's crazy because when his brother passed, I ain't want to be with nobody but Anton. And I was asking Anton, I said, do I got to go up and see him? And he was like, Mom, you ain't got to go up and see him. I said, I don't want to go see him. But I regret going seeing him. I'm telling you, I regret it. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, Anton is my best friend. He a nuisance.
A lot of stuff my cousin did, I always got the charge for it, though, just because we looked alike. Rest in peace to my little cousin Big, man. He's a good dude, man. Died behind some phony shit that wasn't even really worth it, though. But now I'm 35, man, I done been through so much. I'm trying to like just humble myself and try to like just be there for the younger generation and push them in the right direction, though. Because a lot of dudes, man, that come up with us. Whoa! A lot of dudes that come up with us, man, they get a little success. See a little bit of money and they run straight from the hood, though. Like, don't come back
embrace the hood, help the little kids, then they wonder why the community turned against them, though. Like the little saying say, though, man, dudes can't even come back home, man. They did a lot of foul shit, man. They ain't play their cards right, man. I'm always accepted in the hood, man. The hood love me. Hello? I'm walking now, like, you know, skip my mind. Yeah, that's basically where I'm at with it, man. If I can turn one or two kids in a positive direction, man, that's what I want to do, though. But, you know, I got the bad reputation, though. High head, name always and shit. A lot of shit don't even have nothing to do with me. I get the charge, but that come with it, though. Plus, I got the heart anyway, though. That's a lot of people be lacking, though. My man right here, he fell when we was young though. Pulled his arm 15, he home though, back fresh. He ain't miss a beat though, we right back in tune. Trying to fix things in the community, man. So that's what we for, man, we all for our community, man. Hello? Listen what I'm saying, I'm in the middle of an interview and I still answer the phone for you though. You always just jumping out there though. Like, who ain't though? What you mean, tell us something, bro? What you talking about?
Hey, man, you're
just gonna turn it off, though. I'm about to walk right here, right now.
Man, can you tell me something about Lucas?
OG, a real OG. A real OG for what he did in this community. Not for people look at OGs, niggas who got 1,000 bodies, the niggas that have sold 50 million bricks, the niggas that did a whole bunch of reckless roofing shit. Nah, he's an OG because that's his community. He take care of his community. Anybody out here get booked, he the first one with bail money. Anybody out here got a problem, he the first one kicking out money. He ain't the richest nigga in America, but he make it look good, though. You feel me? Yo, do what he gotta do to provide for his family. His life familiar. We all his life familiar. Everybody in this hood is. You feel me? I'm his little cousin. You feel me? But yeah. At the same time, he embraced me like a father, especially when it come to this street shit. Cause I jumped off the porch. I ain't had no business being out here. Luke used to give me $50 and kick me up my ass, tell me to go here. Every time he saw me. Every time. But hard-headed like I am, I wanted to be just like yo, so I followed your footsteps. I wish I would've listened to him though, you feel me? Told me 1,000 times, keep hooping. Keep doing what you're doing, keep going to school. Now I'm here. But I'm good though, cause he with me. I'm blessed cause he with me. I'm blessed cause I got niggas like Big Mom right here with me. Whoa.
What's up, man? What it do, man?
It was Murphy Holmes like, yeah.
Oh man, real treacherous, man. Shit was real hectic, man.
Head down bottom nigga.
Shit was real hectic, man. I don't know, man. I don't know what to tell you, man. You know what I mean?
What
how I was, man. They already told you about it.
One of the originals, man. He's still out here. He's a lot of them. You ain't even saying, man. You got all this fake, flashy, fluke shit, IG shit going on. You got the niggas who ain't even saying, man, who just chilling, working hard, taking care of the family. Like, yeah, making sure everything get done, man, for the people we love, man. No matter how I look on the outside looking in, they always gonna have something to see about us down here. Shit, we could even terrorize everybody, so they say. We chilling though, man, trying to get this paper in all type of ways. Free Jimi Hendrix, man, Jazz Mode Jim, boy, don't we talk, bro? They love him in the region of Maryland. Yeah.
Fuck your shit,
sir.
No, you don't.
Fuck
your shit. You feel me?
Come here. Hey,
yo, what's up,
yo? My man, son, Lil Rel, you know what I mean? Say what's up. What's your name is?
Yeah.
Come here, Fly. My man.
that is, bro.
What's that?
We recording you. We recording you. Got to talk.
Yo, face deal. It's not your father, yeah, sir. That's my man, son, Lil Rel. His father locked up right now. You know, niggas gotta look out for him, though. You know, make sure he's good. You know what I mean? Hey, man, my grandmother got 13 kids, man. You know what I mean? She got 7 daughters and up to 7 girls. 6 of their kids, out of the 6 daughters, all their kids were living with my grandmother at one time.
Wow.
It was, listen, I'm gonna break it down to you.
Down Murphy Home?
Down Murphy Homes on the 3rd floor.
How many bedrooms was it?
3. I'm ready to do the math for you right now. You can count, can't you?
Yeah.
Now listen to me then. Go up and count with me.
Let's go.
It was my grandmother and my grandfather and my little cousin, Mama, who's sitting right here to the left. She was a baby.
Okay. Shout out.
They was in the front room.
Right.
The middle room, that was the girl room. We had my little cousin Ashley. We had my cousin T with her newborn baby. Uh-huh. My cousin Pebbles with her newborn baby. Mm. You know what I mean? Then we hit the back room. Oh man, we had to get a spot. You stayed out too late, you might be on the floor.
Wow.
It was me, my little brother Mooka. It was Dal Rico. You know what I mean? My cousin Rome, my cousin Mikey. Clinton, he was already out there. He was already doing his thing. So it was like 13 of us, 9 of us in one apartment. And my grandmother made it work. You know what I mean? She made it work, man. She used to have to get up.
Grandmothers, man.
Man, she used to have to get up sometimes, man. 5 in the morning to get us together, man. I got to put Jerome's shirt on because she forgot to wash. It was hard, you know what I mean? And that's what made us closer because all my cousins like brothers to me. You know what I mean? Especially Mikey. So we ate it rough. When I say rough, I mean to the point where as though in the projects, if they turn the heat off, you got to really boil. You got to boil the water on the stove. You got to put the iron on the iron and let it heat up, and do all that.
Wow.
Then you got to take a bath with that same water. It was crazy. The same water she made oatmeal what we had to wash up with, basically.
Right.
You know what I mean? So yeah, it wasn't always bad. All that came after the drug addiction. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? See, my mother wasn't addicted. She wasn't addicted to the crack. She was addicted to cocaine. You know what I mean? Straight coke. You know that's what we call it. And that addiction wore my mother out, man. You know what I mean? I seen my mother break down, man. When I say break down, she ain't look Herman to me, man.
Wow.
So that always kept me away from it, man. Like, keep your nose clean, man. Right, you know man. What I mean? That ain't no future for nobody, man. If anybody out there got anybody out there in their family, anybody love with a drug addiction, man, call them, man. Tell them keep their head up, man. Work with them. You know what I mean? That's tough.
Yeah.
That's a tough addiction, man. For those of you that don't know, it's tough. I seen my mother go through it, man.
I had an OG tell me that before. My father used to get high, and like I was never close to him because of that. And yo told me like, man, you can't judge that man. You feel me? Because you don't know what he's going through. It's hard.
Yeah,
it's hard to kick that habit, man.
Yeah, that's a habit. It's like selling drugs.
Some of my sister, but it's fucked up because you go through shit and you see, and that's why I just made a decision to sit around just to get on it. I could have just went home and take to my kids. I came in. You feel me? That's my nigga, like, that's my brother. Taught me how to go up and be a man. If we could jump in a time machine right now and went back to Murphy Homes, what's some shit we'll see?
Yeah,
you'll see a lot, though. You ain't lying. You'll see a lot. Like, if you jump in time, like, you'll see a lot. Like, fighting. There's a lot of fighting. Like, it wasn't this calm. People be fighting and doing a lot of other shit. Yo! All right, hold up. They be fighting, you know, yeah. Like, it be a lot of shit shooting every night. Like, I lived on the edge when I was a kid. That's like I was like a baby, you feel me? You know what I mean? I was running through.
I lived around that. I lived 1129 Augalla. You know, that's where I grew up at, Augalla
House. It's tough, you know, you can't really change nothing.
Good days, bad days, fun. Fun majority of, you know, when I was young. We had fun, we went everywhere.
Living you love.
Yo,
shit don't change, though. Same shit. You know what I mean? Don't nothing change. Same shit. Repeat yourself, you know what I mean?
I'm
bad. God be
blessed. Yo, you grew up off of you, nigga. This nigga talk about fans, right?
Yeah, I know, man. For you, man. Good blessing, man.
I wish everybody could be here, man, to get on this and do this, man. Everybody, man. People that's locked up, people that's dead.
Name some names, man.
same people, loyalty, you know, Archie, you know, R.I.P. is a Muslim, Sean, E.D., Troll, Tar, you know.
Nigga in jail, jump.
Yeah, it's just a lot of niggas just right there, man, that would love to be here to see a lot of my
to see that shit.
I'm saying, it's just a lot going on down here. You got people making music, you know. You got pranking up, doing that thing, you know.
It's a lot. Shit goes down, it go out, you know what I mean?
Hell yeah, I'm saying,
God! I already know. Like, you're a man, you already know what the nigga I'm like. Shit ain't gonna change. You got kids growing up around here, young kids. They older now.
That's that nigga E-up.
Hey!
I'm hiding with my big boys, man. You feel me? And I was the kid that went to the
hospital. Go ahead, get on here, man.
Shit is fucked up. You don't know. I'm going to down there, man. All that love is this. You see my nigga. Boy, be cautious. You know what I'm saying? We here.
Yes, sir. Man.
There ain't no
Jerry, 89. That first funeral, man, made me realize, man, anybody can die. Because when you that young, you don't even think nobody that you know can die, especially being 11 years old, than the way he died, you know what I mean? I'll never forget how it happened, man. It's like that shit be playing in my head over and over. It been almost 30 years ago. We was coming from down the Baltimore Arena, and we was selling water, but we was selling balloons from my homeboy, Big Hand Wood, that his soul rest as well, and my man, Fat Anton. And we came up the way. It was this dude selling horseback rides for a dollar. So, you know what I mean? It's to walk you down, like from Sue's. Sue's was the corner store on Ogden and Huffman. And to walk you down the 900 building for a dollar. But my man, Juice, he was like a year older than me, though. You know, we was bad little Project Rippion's kids. You know, we ain't care about nothing. But nobody said. So he got on the horse, and he kicked the man. And the horse took off running down 900. So, you know, we laughing and shit, crying, laughing and all that. But he ain't never come back. So, it was this dude named Flat. He was real tall. He used to live in 725 building. He came over there like, what the fuck y'all over here laughing at? We like, man, Juice, little badass, took the man horse, man. Y'all better start disrespecting y'all elders, man. Y'all know God don't like ugly, man. When y'all do stuff like that, something bad happens. So, you know, we laughing. We little kids, we ain't paying that shit no mind. So he came back. Juice came back and shit. So when he came back, by the time he came back, I'm in the house though. I was living 2K. And he was living next door, like 2G. So his mother, Miss Debbie, she was on the porch calling his name, Juice, because it was starting to drizzle. So as she on the porch calling his name, I'm on the porch next door, which probably sit like where that car at right there. But I could see like his balcony, and I could see the whole front of the projects facing Argo Avenue. So he coming in the building. It's him, my mother, my cousin Andre, and my man Behind Wood. All four of them coming in the building. It was a little, on the ninth floor project, the balcony chipped off. And it came down, hit him directly in the middle of his head. Now I don't believe in no coincidences, man. There ain't no way in the world, no. In my eyes, I looked at like, how can somebody die like that? Out of four people, the rock hit the baby. You know what I mean? And he was just lying there. That's the first time I ever seen a dead body. And it had to be somebody who I love, you know what I mean? I had to play with him every day, you know what I mean? That really touched me. And I was like 10. And that shit woke, that's what I knew was real, man. And with that man, Mr. Flex said, because he had just said, man, God don't like ugly. And it made me think, whenever you disrespect your elder to do something wrong, something bad was gonna happen. I know I didn't get to think like that, but that shit scared me, man. Ever since then, I always try to respect my elders, you know, man.
Sure, I would see him, that's my man. I would see him, and he would just want to be with us. He would want to be with us. Me, Andre Poole, Walt Clayton, all you name it. We all was out there, man, I'm saying to you. And he would be running through. And we would try to catch him like, boy, just settle down and do what you gotta do, man. And he'd be with us. But he was younger. So, you know, we just groomed him, you know what I'm saying, too. And he just followed our footsteps, man. You know? But he always been a good kid, man.
And like, being in the streets, I always try to keep my kids away from that type of shit that I went through, especially my son, because he a boy. You know, even though he gonna make his own decisions sometimes, if, you know what I mean? And he find out the hard way or the soft way. You know what I mean? He 19 now, so some of the decisions he make them on his own. But I guess God got him through them, you know what I mean? And still gotta be there for him, because he gonna make some, he gonna have some bumps. You know what I mean? So,
can you say that you're proud of the way that he is compared to what he could have been?
Hell yeah. When I was 19, I had two kids. I had already been sent away from home at least 8 times already. 2 times in the adult system and 6 times in the juvenile system. You understand what I'm saying? I was hustling. You know what I mean? I ain't graduated from high school. So he doing way better than me at the age of 19. So yeah, I'm proud of him. Hell yeah. I mean, he fucked up before, you know what I mean? I ain't saying he no angel. But compared to me, yeah, it's like a 90% gap between where I was when I was 19 and where he was. I was knee deep in the game when I was 19. Talk about knee deep at the age of 19. I was in the game heavy. So yeah, I'm proud of him. As far as that.
Do you think a lot of you is installed in him?
Yeah. All the way down to the bone. Yeah.
What are some of the things people say that y'all are alike?
We got the same attitude. We got the same kind of heart. You know what I mean? We get the same, you know what I mean? Same, we get the same motherfucker. He gets younger, that's all.
What can you say for your father?
He a good father. He always did what he had to do. He looked out for me and my sister.
What's going on, man? We're here chilling with my Uncle Luke, man. Man, we in a big enjoy these festivities, man. Live from the 8.
What we doing?
Enjoy these festivities.
Jazz.
Yes. I love your work,
jazz,
boy.
Man.
Jazz festivities.
Anton Carter, a.k.a. Lucas. I mean, live right here in the flesh. It's my uncle, man. OG the hood, man. Yeah, I'm a young OG.
Oprah, man.
We trying to get on Oprah Winfrey, man. Shout out to Oprah, man. Matter of fact, Oprah shut it down, man. We going to take the Dr. Phil, man. Next thing. We try to just go global, man. Just shout out to real niggas all around the world. Real woman. Real woman. Not a female dub. Real woman. Shout out to everybody, man. This is peace, love, and happiness, man.
I'm on Huffman. Phone booth. You should, I'm pretty sure Twan got some footage of what it was.
Yeah, got it.
Everybody couldn't just walk and see there wasn't no food.
Right.
You had to be accepted to even come in that motherfucker. When it was, oh,
Scotty's
first. It was called, really was called Blues.
Yeah.
Yeah, but then you got a lot of dudes that, you know, act like they really from Murphy. They ain't from Murphy for real. Right. You know, we can name us. We can name us, even the dudes that's in prison.
If you don't know the Maxine, you ain't from Murphy Hill. You know what I mean? I had one of the worst hustling habits in the city, man. What I'm saying by that, man, like, by the time I was 15, I already had like 4 or 5 drug charges. Right. And back then, your mother had to come and get you from the police station. There wasn't no baby bookings. Right. So if your mother had come and get you in an hour, they was shipping your little ass out Boys Village.
Right.
By the time you get out there, you might hit a warrant. Now I got automatic 30 days. That shit was automatic back in my days.
Right.
That was automatic. So it went from that, you out there scuffling. You fighting all the dudes, you hear little beef with on the streets.
Yeah.
You fighting them in DC against Baltimore. There weren't no gangs back then. Yeah. It was neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm.
It was like neighborhoods fight. And like I tell you how we used to beef with Lexington's.
Uh-huh.
Lexington's was the same ones that be side by side with us when we go downtown.
Right.
Because now we out of bounds, we out of territory.
Yeah.
We on East Baltimore territory, so now you got Lafayette Projects and Flag House.
Yeah.
So it's dumb against us. So it was fun though.
Yeah.
We knew when we got down the hall, we gonna fight these dudes.
Right.
So we'd be teaming up with Lesson Tires and get back up. Now we back beefing again.
Yeah.
That's how it went. But ain't nobody getting anybody die.
Yeah, it was all love.
Ain't nobody die. So when I really came up and when I really got into like the game, it's when I came home. I was probably like 18. You know, my man and them, you know, my man Lord T, you know what I mean? Ham, all of them, they was already like fully grown and tall while I was, you know, doing my little 18 months.
Yeah, right.
So I came home like, damn, you know what I mean? These dudes shining.
Yeah.
So of course,
Jump right back out.
They put me in there. I had to jump out there. They had a spot waiting on me. It was a rule. Right, you know what I mean? That was my mindset. They was waiting on me. So we came home. Of course, we ran it up. We lowered dude 18, 19. Bop, 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 bop. We doing this, we doing that. You know what I mean? And then we had this strategy. I can't even get it. I think my little man Weasel. My man got hit, man. That's what I'm trying to say. My man Todd. Todd got hit. You know what I mean? When Todd got hit.
Boy, take your time, man.
Yeah. Take your time, baby. Let's go to break, man. Let's go to break.
When Todd got hit, that shit really fucked everything up, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it made us stronger, though. That was like our first death after we was grown. You know what I mean? My little man Todd. And he was only 16 when he, you know what I mean? He died in my arms. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? So that, it was like me, Raymond, T, Wani, Doe. You know what I mean? We was out there. It was all of us out there. We stuck together, embraced each other. Yeah. So we all started staying down Warney house.
Uh-huh.
That was Aunt Tessie house. That was the spot where we went. Because none of us ain't go home. You know, we left the streets when we was kids, so going back home wasn't an option.
Yeah.
So we was all down there. And that's when more so violence got into our lives. You know what I mean?
Oh, before you go anymore, hold on. We're going to take a little break. Pay some bills so we can get ourselves together. We'll be right back.
This is like watching some people's forces, this is a real life.
Gonna be
this guy,
crazy,
he's like, not fabricating nothing. You can tell he's telling us about Murray, but man, this is some real shit. That's real shit.
Mothers had our kids at young ages, between the ages of 15 and 16. Was a struggle trying to raise these boys to keep them in school out of trouble, do your job, work, and also to make sure that they stayed on the right track. Anton and Davon did a good job. One would be bad sometimes, the other one would be bad, but they stayed together, and at times they did get beaten together, like they all said, in the streets, because Murphy Homes was loaded with drugs at the time, and one thing as a mother, especially a single young parent, you did not want your child to be a product of that. Although sometimes it may happen, but you never forgot these kids and the struggles they went through and what they did, and you treated them like love each and every day. And I think all those lessons from Murphy Homes taught not only me a lot to be a better person, to be a better mother and a strong person, but also taught them to be good individuals, even good fathers to these days, because I see them don't want their children to make the same mistakes they made and to have a more peaceful and blessed life.
Man, to be honest, I don't even really know how the inside of the school looked since the 8th grade. Since 1991, that's the last time I've been in school, because I was always locked up, you know, to juvenile. My school to me was like Boys Village, Hickey School, you know, Victor Cullen, Foster Cat. Even though I was locked up, they still had like regular schools inside those facilities. So I never made a chance to get to the 9th grade.
Boom.
You know what I mean? So I basically got my high school diploma.
Yo,
and Jessup. Jessup
Murray.
You know what I mean? Boom. Got it. You know what I mean? I'm full enough to get it.
Still good.
You know what I mean? Just going back and forth with them. It really like fucked me up a little bit, man. Fucked up a lot of job opportunities for me. They fucked up a lot for me. You know what I mean? There ain't no place for nobody being no jail, man. It was crazy you asked me about school because, you know, I always liked the school. You know what I mean? I think I'm one of the smartest guys I know. You know what I mean? To be honest, like my little cousin Ralph. You know, he's a prime example, man. He ain't no angel, you know what I mean? He make good decisions in life. That's why I like to keep working, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? If I could have been. If I would have got chewed up in that shit when I got chewed up in it, you know what I mean?
I mean,
you're still working, I don't give a fuck way working, you know what I mean? He's doing the right thing. He's doing what he got to do to take care of his family. And that's what we need, more motherfuckers like you, like Shorty, my little cousin. And I look at y'all like a role model, because he ain't do none of this shit that I did. When I was his age, I was in jail. You understand what I'm saying? That's why we need more of these, that's why we need more men. Not more men, we need more fathers to come forth. Because you know how many niggas, you know how many little kids out here right now? Who don't got a father figure, even if you ain't taking care of your son, then it's life, man. That shit important. See, I really can't speak for everybody in the neighborhood, but in my neighborhood, I feel like I'm relevant. If you feel like you're relevant in your neighborhood, you should do what I do, man. You know what I mean? even though I ain't in the streets no more, I'm still feeling relevant because I feel like if I'm ain't outside walking up and down Pennsylvania Avenue, who gonna give the little kids out there dollars and quarters to go to the corner store? Because if we don't give them dollars and quarters, you know what they're gonna do? They're gonna go in the corner store and steal the shit. So we do get back to the neighborhood in a sense. You know what I mean? You gotta think about all that, man. So you know what I mean? Motherfuckers like us, we relevant, man. We most definitely is relevant in that hood because we mean something. You know what I mean? You don't know how many situations it be where as though a motherfucker might call you because of a situation that he don't feel comfortable about, he or she, and you can get that situation situated, you know what I mean? So you doing your part in the community, man. You know what I mean? No matter how you do it, man.
So as far as with you and schooling, do you think like if the community was more together in the hood, that it'd be a better place to live?
Yeah, and everybody start going against each other, and everybody start getting caught up in the he say, she say, and all them bullshit ass rumors, the hood would be way better than what it is now. It'd be way better. Nobody ain't got time for all that, man. But you know, it is what it is, you who you are. I'm just saying for me and the guys I grew up with. I know we good dudes, man, no matter what you say, I know there's a lot of good dudes in the city. So like I said again, I'm calling y'all out. Everybody in y'all hood, who say y'all the man, y'all this. Man, holler at me, man. We gonna get together, we gonna do some positive shit for the city. That's what y'all wanna do, man. I'm on Pennsylvania Avenue all day long. I ain't got no money, but I got a voice that can be heard, man, to get some of this shit together, man. So if y'all wanna see me, man, come see me on the Avenue. That's all I got to say about that.